moon blocks. It's like Morse code from the heavens. In this video, we're going to talk about Taiwanese folk religion practitioners and how they hear from celestial beings, ghosts, ancestors, and spirits. And surprisingly, it's not through email.
In the middle of the night, ghosts try to talk to me.
If you go into a Taiwanese temple, you might see them dropping these crescent moon-shaped little wooden blocks. And they're known as moon blocks, or jiaobei, or buoi. The last word is Taiwanese, and I don't speak Taiwanese, so I butchered that. By taking these blocks and dropping them, they can get different results and read those and have answers and communication from the gods or ancestors. The jiaobei have a round top and a flat bottom, meaning that there's three possible combinations they can get. They get two flat, one round, or two round. Like all things with Taiwanese folk religion, there's a bunch of different procedures and versions of it. So one of the common ones we see is what we're gonna talk about today. So the common way to use the jiaobei is to first, you take the wooden blocks and then you take them and move them three times around some incense. And this is considered purifying the jiaobei. And then after that, the person who is the practitioner, he's gonna kneel and he's gonna state some personal information like where he's from, who he is, and then ask his question. I think I do this when I pray sometimes. I'm like, hello God, it's me. He's got like 7 billion people, but I know God knows who me is. So then, after they ask the question, they drop the moon blocks and you get different answers. And so if two of the flat sides are down, then that's a no answer or a negative response. And there's a little bit of intention here because maybe it's a negative feeling or a positive feeling. It's not necessarily always gonna be yes or no, but most of the time it's gonna relate to something that's answerable. And then if it's a one flat and one round, that's a yes answer. Statistically, this is about 50% of the time, so it's gonna most likely be yeses, but they also believe that they're talking to gods and ancestors, so the statistics don't really matter if it's a spiritual practice. And then if you get two round sides down, that's called laughing blocks or laughing answers. And it's interpreted as the god or the ancestors don't want to answer the question, or maybe they think it's even a bit inappropriate. So you would probably re-roll or rephrase or just get out of there. You're like, oh, I don't want to offend this guy. He's laugh and block at all my questions. So there's a famous scholar, Wei Ping Lin, and she mentions that the seriousness and the controversy of different questions can change maybe how you would use interpretation or different rules for the jiaobei. For example, if you have something that's easy to answer, you might just want one positive outcome. You're like, ah, you know, I got my answer. But if it's like really serious, you want to be absolutely sure that the gods are in it, that your ancestors are in it. So you're gonna maybe want to get three or four positive answers from the jiaobei in a row.
I like to call my parents right now.
Sure.
Use my lifeline, call my parents.
And it makes sense. Like the advice that you'd get before baking a meal or getting a haircut is very different from your community wanting to go to war. Like you're gonna wanna make sure that maybe you put a little bit more seriousness and gravity into those things. Moon blocks are also very important for a place like East Asia, which is not a confrontational culture. So imagine you're arguing as a community and you have this important decision. Everybody just fire there, they're all banging the tables. They're like, I'm gonna murder you because you're not gonna vote the way I want. Well, if a decision's big and it's gonna affect the whole community, you can actually, instead of the community doing the decision, they can pass it off to the gods. And then they have a neutral person who can solve this problem for them. So it's very good in the culture here. Maybe they have to make a decision at a temple or as a family, they can kind of use it as a mediator.
A mediator's tool chest.
Finally, jiaobei might also be accompanied by fortune sticks. So there's these little sticks and they got fortunes on them and they're in a little jar. And you'll pick them up and the jiaobei will be what confirms that it's for you and not for someone else, which is kind of important because there's like 400 fortunes in this little box. And so that's another function of them, but the fortune divination, that's for another time. Many homes also have these blocks for communicating with the family gods or the ancestors. It's not just something you see in temples and it's not just reserved for them. They're also used on a somber occasion. Like if you're at a funeral and you're waiting for the spirit of the person who died to arrive because it's not their body and spirit aren't always in the same place, and there's a lot of ritual involved with that. You might use the jiaobei to confirm that they're there. So instead of moon blocks, you might actually see them use traditional coins from the Japanese period of Taiwanese history as well. And that's probably going to be for non-serious inquiries, like things at home, because they want to know sometimes if they leave an offering out, did the gods or the ancestors get their fill of the food? And so the jiaobei is used to kind of understand that and make that decision. So moon blocks are pretty versatile, and despite having only three answers, they're still pretty important for people to make decisions here, especially religious decisions. And there's more complex ways that people tell the future and hear from the gods. Like sometimes they use birds and sticks and they read those somehow, but it's time for comparing and contrasting. So let us know in the comments below if you'd be interested in knowing more about Taiwanese folk religion, how they talk to gods, and bird divination. We can actually probably go film that. Compare, contrast. Oddly enough, the practice of Urim and Thummim, I actually literally talked to a pastor like an hour ago about how to pronounce this because he knows Hebrew. I cannot remember. Urim and Thummim.
Uma Thummim.
When Thummim, the Urim and Thummim.
Called the Urim and Thummim.
Urim and the Thummim.
It might be one of the most similar things we see in the Taiwanese temple to what's shown at the Jewish temple. There's actually a lot of similarities, but this is one that's kind of like really similar. So during the time of Aaron, back in biblical history, the priests would wear a special garment called an ephod. And it was like blinged out. There's like bedazzled little jewels everywhere. Like it's gonna turn heads at Paris Fashion Week.
I think this big, quite baggy, gigantic coat with a full skirt is actually really chic.
So the ephod was used in worship, and they had these objects called the Urim and Thummim, and they don't have a lot of detail in the Bible, but we know they were used to talk to God in a very similar way to the moon blocks. We actually see in 1 Samuel an example of the objects being used in a form of divination or to communicate with God. And scholars think that they're probably used by like powerful people, like the generals, to make important decisions. Like you wouldn't just walk in the temple and be like, yo, give me some Urim and Thummim. I need to know what's on the menu today. Should I cook rice or should I cook pasta? Like it wouldn't be like that. But instead it'd be like, are you gonna go to war? Do we think God is okay with this decision? But there's not a lot of details, so we don't know if it was just a yes or a no. Some people said that they would glow, and maybe if it glowed a certain way, they'd have an answer. Unfortunately, a lot of this has been lost to time, but my favorite source comes from these old Jewish sources, and they said that the Urim and Thummim had the name of God inscribed on them on a piece of paper, and it was put into the ephod. They call the name of God the Tetragrammaton too, which is like a crazy word for a name.
What is God's name?
Howard.
How do you know God's name is Howard?
Our Father who art in heaven, Howard be thy name.
And when a question is asked, you had the 12 jewels in the ephod, and they would all light up and give an answer, which sounds like pretty rad. I don't know though if like it was kind of like beep beep boop beep 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 boop, but whatever it was, they could use the 12 things, get these answers. It probably is more complex than a yes or no. So we just don't know how it worked, but we do know historically there's some interesting stories about that. And at one point, it stopped being used. People like Josephus, who's pretty controversial, says that it was stopped being used about 200 years before his lifetime. Some people thought the last time we see it being used is David, around that time. We do see Saul try to use it actually at one point, and it doesn't really work because Saul.
My God, he don't like you and he loves everyone.
How can we hear from God if we don't have a system like the jiaobei today?
If Noah Instagrams one more time about his DIY project, I'm done.
It's too much. Like he's like, I'm getting these instructions from heaven.
Oh, yeah.
Doubt it.
I ain't getting on that boat.
Over the span of history, God would send prophets who hear from him and could speak on his behalf. And eventually, God came in the form of Jesus, and he raised up disciples and apostles. And through this, God slowly created and revealed what we know as the scriptures of the Bible. And what was left for us was this incredible resource for hearing the voice of God. Many religions have holy books, but one thing that makes the Bible different is it's considered a living book. So Hebrews 4:12 says that the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The idea is that the Bible is this living thing that actually can reveal the heart and pierce your heart and change you. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. So the Bible also says that it's breathed out by God. And the Bible uses the breath of life to explain how humanity comes from the dust and he breathes the breath of life into it. Actually, all life has the breath of life in it. And using the scriptures as God breathed shows that the scriptures are alive. It's not a dead book. It's not dusty pages. The scripture has this supernatural power to it. So Christianity doesn't have a lot of this crazy cosmic supernatural stuff, but we believe that the scriptures are very supernatural. They have a power to change your life, to be relevant to you no matter what's going on in your life, to be relevant to you 2,000 years from now or 2,000 years ago. It's incredible what the Bible can do. God has given Christians something so powerful it can tell you the actual heart and mind of God. The idea is that scripture's not passive. It's the word of God, the very breath of God. And so his words are gonna apply to you today and in the past. Jewish people have poured through it for thousands of years, and even 1,500 years ago, when we see the Talmud being formed, there's thousands of pages of commentary from rabbis. Like, this book has like encyclopedias worth of commentary before we invented encyclopedias. So how would that even happen? Because it's alive. Like, the insight of scripture is powerful. It's uniquely special because, like, simple sentences like those found in the book of Proverbs could lead to whole books being written about them. Or the Psalms, they encapsulate the human experience, but also the divine experience. There's something just amazing about that, but you don't have to take my word for it. You need to try this simple exercise. Take a verse like a proverb or something good, not like, don't like do a genealogy, although I'm not saying God can't use a genealogy, but take something like a proverb, right? Memorize it, think about it, dwell on it. And I promise you, a week, 2 weeks from now, you're gonna see something where you say, oh, this applies to me. Like, it's crazy. That's the power of the word of God. It's living and breathing. As we apply it to our lives, it grasps on to the lives we live. So you should try that. It's a great experiment, and you can learn about scripture that way. And speaking of application, you should take a moment and apply some pressure to that subscribe button. We recently hit 200 subscribers. Pretty stoked. Not like bake a cake stoked, because we got a long way to go, but we reach way more people with our nice little spiritual truth, so we love it when you subscribe. Is there a proverb or a verse that speaks to you? Or do you want to get one? Let us know in the comments below, and if you ask for a verse, we'll give you a verse.
We're going to compare, contrast with a big compare and a contrast from me to you. Won't you say compare, contrast to...